All right, 7 o'clock on March 14th, we'll call the meeting of the Conway Board of Selectmen to order. First item on our agenda is the minutes. We have minutes for February 22nd, February 29th, and March 7th. Has everybody had a chance to look at those minutes? Do we have any changes?
Yeah, for March 7th, in my report, I said subscribing to Microsoft Exchange on Windows 365 would be $3,000 per workstation per year. That's not true. It's $3,000 per year for all workstations.
Okay.
They just trying to make this, Jim wasn't here, I think, that cut out.
Yeah, right.
Other than that, that's, looks good.
Okay.
And I can't vote on that one.
Right. All right, so I'll ask to approve the minutes of February 22nd and February 29th as is. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And now ask for a vote on the March 7th minutes as amended for Tom's correction and the correction of taking Jim out of that that meeting. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Next item is meetings attended by the Board of Selectmen. Any meetings this last week?
No.
Next item is citizens' concerns. Do we have any citizens' concerns?
I have one, if I may, as a citizen. As a new beekeeper, I was concerned about a Recorder article I just read about pollinators in today's Recorder. And the possibility of the way they'll be spraying, they can spray without notification or without telling you exactly what they're using. And I think it's a bigger picture than just pollinators, which has become a worldwide serious concern. And I don't know what all the details are yet about that, and neither did the article seem to know, the reporter. So I'm hoping that that will not get out of hand. I'm in the process of reading Rachel Carson's Silent Spring. It is so, it's almost as though she wrote it this year, if anybody remembers that book. And I think it's a message of very serious concern for all of us.
Okay. Could you do some more research on that and bring us back some details?
I will do the best I can.
Thank you.
Okay.
Brian, do you have any?
Well, I kind of want to, I represent the Franklin County Tech School from Conway. I just wanted to report on a few things. I thought it would be a good day today. We have 8 students going from Conway. You guys probably already know it's $132,076, which equals out to about $16,509 per student. The budget that we presented, that was presented to us, was passed at $10,349,700. They're doing some paving in the parking lots. That's going out to bid soon. I guess it's already out there now. They're replacing all the windows and doors in the school right now at a cost of about $1,656,723. They're also recoating the roof, which was put on. It's one of those membrane roofs that was put on over 20 years ago. That went out for bid. I guess that came back at $454,800. There's some things going on there. So far right now, the tech school has 137 applicants. Numbers are down, but the numbers are down for the last few years, but they're down in all the schools. So everybody's kind of like fighting for all the students they can get. So they're sitting pretty good, I guess. They've actually made a little clip that they're showing at the movie theaters. It's at the Gardner and the Hadley Cinemas. They're also trying to get at the Greenfield Gardens. It shows a bunch of little shops, a little thing, and it says Franklin County Tech School on it. It's actually going to show 17,000 times next month at those two places.
Wow.
And hopefully, we're going to get at the Greenfield Gardens, too. And you can also apply online and on through Facebook to go to the tech school now, so that's kind of neat too. So they're doing a whole bunch of different things. And one other thing, the superintendent wants to come and visit the town of Conway. And I wanted, you know, he wants me to kind of show him around, and I thought maybe one or two of the select board people would be more than happy to help me out, and what days would be good, so that I could go back to him and kind of finalize a day. Because he'd love to come up and see this town.
This is the new superintendent?
Yes, yep. Richard Martin. So, I have
a volunteer. Coordinate with Tom and, yeah.
Yeah, I'd be willing to go with you on that.
Yeah, I just, he wants to come up, he wants to see the town, he wants to know what's going on. I know I mentioned something to Mr. Baker, and he had mentioned something about taking him on the bus route so he knows when it snows what it's like to be out here in Conway. So I thought maybe I'd contact the bus company and see if I could get a route so I know exactly where the bus goes, and maybe take a ride in my truck and show him what the route's like, so when it snows, maybe he'll call the snow day a little bit quicker.
Yeah.
Right, so.
Yeah. Okay. And I read somewhere that they had some extensive repairs that were needed, and it was going to be expensive. That's big money.
It is. I know for the windows and doors, I think they were trying to get a bond or something like that. Greenfield Co-op, I think, had it come in at 0.72%. Mm-hmm. So.
Mm-hmm. Did most of your increases here due to most students going?
The enrollment's down, so, I mean, that's why.
The Conway's enrollment is down to it?
It's only 8 students.
What was last year?
I don't have that available right now. I thought there was. Was there anybody that graduated last year from Conway? I didn't think so.
When I first came to town, there were a lot of kids in town who went to school there.
Okay. So, great. Thank you, Brian.
All right.
Appreciate that.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And we'll be in touch with who wants to go for a ride.
Yep.
Tom, thank you. Tom can probably coordinate that.
Thank you, Tom.
Sure. Okay. Our next item of business, town meeting warrant items so far. Tom?
Yeah. I have a couple of, you have a copy of the draft warrant as it stands as of today, which is everything that came in. We should take this item to close the warrant at this point. I've got placeholders for everything there needs to be a placeholder for. I also have the, there's something you have there, additions to the draft town meeting warrant. That's the one. That's the one. So, in brief, up at the top, the additions since the last time we met include an article for the 250th anniversary committee. I reinstated the library article, though the motion might read differently. Mm-hmm. I have to work that out with the Board of Library Commissioners. The next two are pipeline related. One has to do with water and air quality testing along the route. The other has to do with donating $5,000 to Montague's intervention with the Department of Public Utilities. Article 24 is to, it would allow only Conway residents to be voting members of committees. Mm-hmm. Article 25 is something that I added, and I'll have more on this next week. The Department of Revenue came up with a bunch of recommendations back in March 2012. Mm-hmm. And this is one of them. And it would allow, the town meeting has to authorize any contract over 3 years. Right. This would allow the select board to make 5-year contracts for town audits.
Right.
There's a general bylaw having to do with junk cars and a zoning bylaw. They affect each other, so it's a pair. And then there's a zoning bylaw from the planning board again to add to the solar overlay district that we have now. And the details as I have them, which are not complete, we don't have the numbers for the air and water testing for the pipeline baseline, but everything else is pretty complete underneath if you just want to see those. And those are incorporated into this draft warrant that you have. So I do want to mention those.
Also, since Brian was just here, I'll note that in the budget that I put out, I used the correct number, but in this Article 2, I do not have the correct number under technical schools. It's actually considerably more, because this is just the number for Franklin County Tech. The actual number is $204,094, which is obviously a lot more.
That includes Smith, right?
That includes Smith Tech, yes. And I apologize for that. I'll rework all of those numbers.
So 204,000?
Yeah. And $94. That said, those are the updates on the town meeting warrant, but I again would urge as per the schedule, this would be the meeting to close the warrant.
Okay, we're not expecting anything else to come in?
No.
Okay. All right, then I'll make a motion that we vote to close the warrant as of tonight. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Next item is the Open Space Committee proposal for botanical inventory and natural resource options for the Rose Field. All right, we went over this last week. Michelle, would you just give Jim a quick summary of that?
So
we didn't want to sign this without you being
here.
Okay. Can I sign it?
I think that's fine.
I don't know if you have any particular questions, but the gist of it is that Gloria Sanders, the naturalist who used to do the field notes program on the well-known naturalist in the area, has offered to do a report for us, for the town, on the natural history and cultural history of the field, of that property, with an eye towards contributing to the ongoing plans that she's very well informed on. She's read all the different committees' reports so far. Regarding what may happen with that field, and it would be a valuable resource for the town. It backs up the Open Space and Recreation Committee report, and the monies would come from, Tom can tell you the exact fund, but there are existing monies. Something about cities, grants, you want to?
Yeah, the town has gotten money over the years from a small cities grant to help implement the open space and recreation plan. So that's the special account we're drawing on.
So and the Open Space Committee voted to endorse the idea of using the monies for this purpose.
Yeah. Sounded good when I read it.
Okay, do you have any questions, Jim?
No.
Because we basically agreed with principle last week. Sign it.
Okay.
All right.
Sure.
So I'll make a motion that we sign the contract that's been recommended by the Open Space Committee for a proposal to do a botanical inventory and natural resource options for the Rosefield property. Do you have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye. John, there should be two copies of the contract in the yellow folder. One for us and one for them.
Do you have a copy, Jim?
If they're not,
I think I have one. So maybe that would be.
It could be in Joyce's mailbox because she has to sign off as well at some point. So,
yes,
so
that whole thing.
Oh, the whole thing?
Yeah. Everything with this first page.
Oh, okay.
So it's...
There it is.
I've seen something.
Well, no, that's not it either.
Yeah, so the next to last page.
Is that one? Okay, here's a second. Yeah, here we go. We got two copies.
Okay, two. I've got my money in there. And again, it's just one for us and one for her. And Joyce will have to sign off on this too before it goes to the contractor.
Sign this too. Thank you, Michelle. My next item on the agenda is the report from the Housing Committee. Tixie?
Hi. I'm here to give feedback to the Select Board about the contractual relationship we had with the LDS consulting firm from Newton, Massachusetts. And I have copies here for you of this is the specific answers to the survey questions, amazing amount of graphs and graphics. And then this, they look the same on the front, but just note, this one is the housing supply and demand analysis of what's going on around us. So let me just send those down to you. And then at the meeting last week, anticipating that it was last week, we had supplied to the selectmen a two-page sort of analysis, condensation of all this material. When last year at town meeting, the CPA generously gave us $22,500 for this work. And we had in mind a certain sequence, which would have been to conduct the housing market study, which is one of those. The second is to conduct a community survey and to prepare that report. Thirdly was an analysis and recommendations for the units. What kind of demand, what kind of type, what kind of cost, rental versus purchase. And then lastly, to prepare these conceptual budgets for this project based on third-party estimates. And so she worked, her name is Lynn Sweet, she worked with the Berkshire Design people who did the conceptual design, and the two of them worked together really well to give us a set of figures for what it would cost. The last section would be to seek town approval for that portion of the town on land, but we are stopping at this point because the results of her analysis, they were really excellent, by the way, and I know I've talked to a few of you. She was really pleasantly surprised to understand the character of our town. When she first started, she had some really different conceptions of what Conway was, coming from the eastern part of the state, working with a different population. And to watch her morph and transition into someone who so understood our town, by the time she was done with all the analysis, she said, "You live in such a special place." So it really felt good that we got her to understand who we were. But with that, you know, I don't know how to do this because it's very comprehensive. I really don't want to take the time to go over it. Could we just leave it to a few folks? I'm assuming you read it, mm-hmm. and you have comments or questions about it. We could maybe do that.
Could you say a couple of words about your next steps?
Well, our next step is presenting this to you, and we are, the conclusion is that there is no housing available to our seniors in the area. The conclusion is that there is a significant amount of people that want to take advantage of it. But the conclusion when we looked at the estimate of cost is we have about a $700,000 shortfall for that particular piece of property. So what I was coming to you was to have that discussion questions and then come to a resolve of where we should go from that point.
They made some recommendations on unit type and cost.
Yes.
I don't see anything about square foot area in this.
Well, it was based on the top set of units. There are six. They are 1,000 square feet. And the bottom at the walkout level, which would be level with the ground on the other side, were 750. And then they used the estimate of $160 per square foot. The real kicker, and I think Bob, you'd seen a lot of these, was the estimation of the infrastructure became very high. We knew that fill was going to be an issue, but we need a specialized fill, type that doesn't have any organic matter. We were heard about the flood mitigation. We went, oh, can we have that fill? You know, but we have to have, it's like a very fine gravel. You can't build underneath any type of fill. In that we are a rural community, we have to put in our own water, we have to put our own well. So when she put it all together and she did this amazing analysis, again, I think, Bob, you saw those numbers, it comes out that the infrastructure is the biggest problem.
Right. And that's one of my questions. What was it, just over $1 million, I think, wasn't it?
I'm sorry?
It's just over $1 million for the infrastructure work, I think.
Right, and then...
that's before you even start building.
When she first gave us some of her figures, she hadn't put in garage space, which we feel some type of carport or garage would be important. And she also initially hadn't figured in the 12.5% benefit to a developer. But she also hadn't figured in that we want all 12 units to be residents. We had first hoped one of them could be for storage for the residents and another could be for senior housing, but we can't afford that. It has to be income-producing units. So that made us reconfigure, and we ended up with a $700,000 shortfall. And I think you've all heard, you know, we're very, very committed to this not being based on property taxes, town's taxes, rather. But it's always been, you know, a combination of green grants, CPA money, market value. People are going to have to purchase these. And then lastly, and this is what I wanted to talk to you about, is do we seek a benefactor? Someone had come forward about a year or more ago saying that they would be willing to make a contribution as a legacy project in the name of a loved one. That might be a way we could make up that shortfall. We are kind of stymied right now. We really thought we were going to end it, and it was very, very disappointing, but we have this little tiny thread of hope that maybe there's another way we can approach this. So again, that's why we've come today.
What did they come up with as a total cost for the project?
I'm trying to see if I have all of hers. $3 million. That's everything.
$3 million for the units.
For this would be for the 12 units, and we looked at market purchase versus rent. Rents came out too high, would be uncomfortable for people. We're trying to keep our units under $250,000. We'd like to keep it significantly below that. And so those were those other numbers we're coming from.
And all of it has to be, has to generate, you can't have anything else. Because I know we had talked as part of the plan, something like a provision that would be for the use of the people there or for their family members.
That's that other conversation, which was the town park, turning that property into a town park, which could, but that's separate. The housing units stand completely separately.
Okay. The unfortunate thing here is because of the cost is so high, like you said.
Yep.
I'm concerned about, we might price ourselves out of market. We want to do this housing for the people that need it the most in Conway. And those are probably the people that aren't going to afford to pay that big ticket price.
So Bob, as a clarification, I'm sorry. There's going to be, we're suggesting three affordable units. Mm-hmm. And the affordable units drop down to more like 175. Okay, and we might be able to get those even lower. And looking over the demographics of the town, and again, that's what her report does, don't have a lot of people that fall into the affordable need. It's a pretty generous amount of money. But the people, because on the survey, they also tell us how much they'd be willing to afford and what their current monthly expenses are for their housing, indicates that it is possible for plenty of people in town would be still
interested. Your survey, there was no commitment in any part of your survey that went out to the people as to whether they would be willing to do something like this. So,
you know, described as highly likely or highly interested, mm-hmm. mildly interested. No commitment.
But that's the difficult part.
Yeah, you can't really ask that. I mean, a sight unseen. We're saying, I think we posed it as between 750 and 1,000 square foot. Would you be highly, not likely, etc. There was a grade.
How many highly likely did you have?
Well, it ended up being, it was about 28%. And, you know, a lot of us know that we did this as a much less sophisticated survey about 6 years ago, and it was almost the exact same number. It was 26% showed highly likely.
So this 28% is a highly likely response.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And how about likely?
We'd have to look here. Okay. I don't have that. There's so much information.
Maybe 50%. Together.
Together. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I'd say that's fair. Okay.
So that's a pretty good response.
Yeah, their conclusion based on this is the work they do in other towns was they felt that we should go. They were all about us going forward, you know, with each one of those phases until we hit the fill issue, an infrastructure issue, and then they said, "Ooh, you might rethink this," which was really.
And although certainly we'd like all these units to go to Conway residents,
indeed,
we wouldn't be able to really do that.
Why not, John?
Would we be able to?
We've been using West Hampton Woods as our template, mm-hmm. and they were able to construct it so that preference is given to Conway okay. residents, those who work in Conway and related to Conway, mm-hmm. so that we feel we can protect that.
Okay.
Fair housing says you have to open it to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And even in West Hampton, they were required to contact cities all around them and say, anybody interested, including urban areas? Nobody came. West Hampton had 8 units initially. They had such a long waiting list, they've just added 8 more. And they're all from West Hampton. They're not from East Hampton, North Hampton. They're all from West Hampton. And they have a similar demographic size.
These are all units that were purchased by their town residents.
They were all, you know, I can't remember now if those were, I think those are rentals, Bob.
Yeah,
but we found it was cheaper to build it and pay for it if we did purchase versus rental.
I understand that, but have you built in anything for upkeep over longevity of the place?
Capital projects and things like that. This is what her work is, yes.
I mean, we have to look at that too.
Absolutely, you know? Absolutely.
We don't want to fall apart after we get them built and not have money to repair them.
And it won't be town-owned. We have to form a nonprofit so mm-hmm. that the town is not the responsibility of the town except for road maintenance as we normally do. But that all has to be built in. And again, that's what West Hampton did. They created a nonprofit from people in town. And they hired a maintenance group.
One of the first things you're going to have to do then is get town meeting approval to release the land to this prior
yes,
organization.
Right? Absolutely, absolutely. See, that was like our last stage, and we said we're not ready because we have to figure out how to do the shortfall.
Well, I think you want to have all your ducks in a row first.
Well, like I said, how are we going to get that money? Does that seem feasible to any of you for us to make a request to see if people would make a donation or create some type of fund?
So your next step is to overcome this $700,000
exactly.
shortfall.
So we're asking you, you know, should this be something that we bring up as a brief conversation at a town meeting? Should we have an information meeting separate from town meeting and invite the public in for this conversation? I've had a couple of occasions with some people who have said to me, I have some money and I might be able to make a contribution. It's not something I'm comfortable with. I can do all this other stuff, but I'm not good at it. And I just don't know how realistic this is, and we kind of wanted to see what your impression was, whether that's a realistic request or not.
Well, a number of years back, a couple who've been in town for quite a while and have been relatively active in town said to me that one of the things they think this town needs, because they don't want to move out of town.
Exactly.
When they get a little older and don't want to live in their house and have to take care of a bigger house, said what they think we need to start looking into, and now you've been doing it, is that we should have some housing for Conway people who later on would like to stay in town but move out of their houses. So they sell their homes and enough, probably get enough out of their homes to pay for one of these units free.
Yes. You know, I've had over the years, 11, but who's counting, that have been on this, I've had a number of people who are comfortable who've said, I'm ready now. I don't want to own my big house. And they don't want to leave town.
Right.
They're not elderly. They're not in need of support and you know, handicap accessibility. They don't want to leave town, and they don't want to have that big ownership. And that was reflected in the survey as well. So it looks like there's a need and a desire, but we've got this gap. And
I think maybe the Housing Committee should try to move forward and do some informational meetings first and see where that goes. And then come back to us.
That sounds fine.
Ask about the need to come up with all the 700,000. People got any ideas on it?
Yes. Okay.
Great.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Pixie.
Okay.
Great report.
Thank you.
Our next item is Human Resources Study Discussion, representatives of the Personnel Committee. Tom?
Well, Bob is here. Susan is not able to make it any time during the month of March. And you would ask that they come in to discuss what they thought about the study that was done. I had mentioned that they had approved the process. You know, that said, I think the questions that you had were more about compensation, and I would still urge you to accept the job descriptions and classification that were done anyway. That would give me some tools to work with. But Bob can speak more to that if he likes to.
Bob, did you had a chance to look at the study?
Yes, I did. I did, and I pretty much kept the rest of it. The study's done pretty well. I think the problem is the compensation. Do we want to go along with it?
That was one of my concerns too, because the present system we're using is not good. That system could bring in some difficult administrative situations to deal with. Although I think I agree in principle with that system. Okay. So it's, you know, how do we bridge the gap between, you know, what we're doing now and a fairer system that can be managed and administered properly and fairly throughout the whole of our structure. Because, you know, certainly we have job descriptions, we have classifications, and I think he did a great job with his report. It's just that how do we make those comparisons on an annual basis with other towns? For instance, you know, our job description for our laborer could be, you know, a laundry list of things. With another town, their laborer laundry list could be different. How do we compare those two, especially where compensation is concerned? You know,
one of my problems with the proposals was that we have to continually compare all time with other towns.
Exactly. Exactly what I'm saying.
Right.
Is, you know, how do we know that we're comparing like quantities, like qualifications from one to another?
From town to town. We don't. It would become a nightmare to find out.
Exactly my point, you know. So I see the administration could be a huge problem, and it may actually, you know, open up some more liability for the town down the road if we're seen as doing things unfairly. So that's my problem with it. And as you know, HR is becoming a nightmare.
Yes, it is.
To administer, you know.
You know, my feeling was, and I brought this up to Tom, is and I hope you all don't take this wrong, I've been a federal employee all my life. And I know the federal government's on the line right now on a lot of their practices, but I think their HR and their in-step increases are a proper way to do it. You don't have to go out and check every year. You set what we've got now, and then you tie it to a cost of living. So you don't have unfair, you know, it's not unfair. The cost of living is this, your raise is going to be this. Mm-hmm. And it raises across the board, the in-step increases and everything.
See, I agree with making some adjustments to you know, his recommendations. I basically agree with that. It's just, how do we move forward from there?
Well, I can continue to work with the personnel committee on coming up with some way that takes care of your concerns, but nonetheless moves us forward from where we are now. Again, it would be helpful if the other parts of the study were approved, so that I can start working on other aspects.
Have we seen all the job classifications?
I'm sorry?
Have we seen all the job descriptions?
You certainly have access to them.
Access to them, but we haven't looked at them.
Well, you should have gotten yours and the fire department, yeah, for that. And at the same time, any of them were there. You can look at any of them you want. They're, you know, uniforms at this point, which is, I think, the main point is they're all built the same way so that there's no disparity between them.
Yeah. Right after we spoke to Don last time, the FERCOG came out with their annual salary survey. Theirs is an excellent survey. That adds a lot more comfort to a way of evaluating this than the way Don did. Although the way Don did it is fine for what he was doing, but that study that FERCOG did is very comprehensive. Did you get a copy of
that? I didn't get a copy.
Would you make sure,
sure,
the personnel committee gets a copy of that? Because it's tremendous. It's all of Franklin County. They go through all the towns. It's, there we go. And it's, you know, if we had something like this to deal with every year and to look at, which the FERCOG does, that would increase the comfort level of administrating this a lot more.
Well, I'll look this.
They just come out with a new copy?
Yes, yeah.
They do this study every year.
They do it every year. Yeah. So you know, their information is up to date, current. They define a number of levels within each, you know, category, and it's, you know, it's really comprehensive.
I have no problem with doing the studies, but if we do it through the town, we're going to have problems, and it's going to cost a lot of money.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
If we do it through FERCOG, which we're a member of, yep, you know, that's a different story. Will they keep this up, though?
They do it every year,
yeah.
And we have to depend on something that's outside of us to make a judgment here.
Okay. Oh, yeah, I agree.
Yeah. Okay.
Upstairs.
All right. So, Tom, okay, we've got job descriptions and we've got classifications.
Yeah, the six grades.
Right, okay. And the personnel committee is all right with those?
Well, I haven't met with Sue. I mean, it's Sue and I.
It's just Sue and you now.
When you did meet, there was the one change that Sue had that we all agreed with, the job descriptions, changing the wording about essential functions.
Yes.
That was, I think, the only change that you guys had to what he had done.
Yeah, I think we've all agreed on that, too.
Yeah. Well, oddly enough.
I think I feel more comfortable getting this whole board together with us, and I'll come to some sort of consensus agreement before we move forward with some of this stuff. Personally,
I
think, that's my feeling.
All right, so.
And when you understand that they are in favor of the job descriptions and the classification there, but, and I'm not proposing going ahead with the compensation portion of that. But it would help me to have the job descriptions and classification in line.
You've already seen those.
I haven't seen the finished ones. I think I'll look them over, but
yeah, it was just that one change in wording.
Right. Yeah, that was because of the liability issues and the wording raised.
Yeah, according to Sue, yeah.
I agree.
Don, of course, took issue, but...
We were led to believe that you had different ideas on some of this stuff.
Which stuff was that? I mean, we have...
Comments. We had previous meetings from Tom.
Yes.
The people had different concerns, both you and Herb.
Yes, we do. I mean, we come at it from two different directions.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a good thing.
We did, on the compensation end of it, we didn't want to do the surveys. I didn't want to do the surveys in a year, every year. She agreed with that. And I think we should be right in the middle about how much we pay compared to the rest of the area, not at the bottom of the scale. Mm-hmm. I think those were the two issues. It's been a while since we...
And she also did not favor the step increase method of...
And I did.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that was the third.
Yeah. I think the step increase would be the best way to go, because if you start giving it just on merit, or you're going to run into cases like, well, he got it because he likes the guy or they're friends.
Yeah.
Right, we want
exactly,
to stay away
exactly.
Exactly,
right.
Yeah.
Right.
That's exactly one of the problems that occurs in that kind of a system. Okay. But you guys are all right with the job descriptions?
Yeah.
Yeah. And you would like the job descriptions?
Yeah, it would help.
You read the job descriptions?
I read mine. I haven't read any of the other ones because I haven't seen them.
Okay. Do you want to wait before we pass on the job descriptions?
I'd like to see what they all have to say before we get to vote on them.
Okay.
Have you seen them, Jim?
Sure.
Yeah.
You seen them all?
Yeah, I've seen them.
I haven't seen them all yet.
Oh, you haven't seen them
all? Well, I'm not sure. I've read some.
Yeah. Okay.
But I...
I'll mail them out.
Sure.
Okay. And then at next meeting, we'll take up the job descriptions and the classifications.
Sure.
All right.
That's fine.
Okay. So we'll table those two things until next. And then we'll do some more detailed work on... We'll get together with you and Sue on the compensation part of it, and we'll hammer something out.
Okay.
Okay. All right.
The next items are pretty quick, by the way.
Okay. Okay, we have next item on the agenda is the revised insurance contract due to building revaluation.
I actually have two different values that Maya sent us. It was time to revalue the buildings. It hadn't been done in a very long time.
I hope so, based on these revaluations.
The new value is about double. And since there's two different figures, I have an email into them asking them which one we should use. That said, I would plan, when I got the correct number to add, I would like to do it immediately on principle. You might want me to wait till July 1st, but at some point, if I do it immediately, I'll need to get a transfer from the reserve fund from the finance committee. So I would like a little bit of direction on that.
All right, so the increased valuation is going to cost us an additional premium of $2,228.
That is one of the figures. The other figure is at $1,076. So I'm trying to figure out which one they mean. I think that $2,228 includes other items, but I'm not sure. I'm clarifying that now.
All right, so they're telling us that our buildings are valued at this right now.
Yeah.
Okay. And it costs us $2,228 for them to insure up to these values.
Yes.
Okay. Then we have to do this right away.
Okay.
We don't want to be underinsured.
When I find out what the correct figure is, I'll work with the finance committee to request a transfer from reserve fund.
Okay. Now, what do you need from us on that? Anything else?
No.
Okay. Then let's move ahead with that right away.
Yeah.
Because our buildings are now insured for about $2,300,000, and they claim they're worth $5,100,000. So we're underinsured by $2.8 million. So we need to get that up right away for a couple of $1,000s
in case anything
happens between now and July 1st.
Yeah.
Okay.
No,
Tom will just move forward on.
Okay.
Our next item on the agenda is the South River Engineers Permit for New England Environmental.
Technically, it's a contract change. You're now allowing South River, New England Environmental to work on behalf of the town on the South River project, so they can talk directly with the Corps of Engineers and not go through the select board.
Okay, so that is this contract?
Yeah.
Okay, for the, okay. All right, so what we're doing is giving them permission to work with the Corps of Engineers, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody seen this contract? Okay. I'll make a motion that we sign this contract.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Our next item on the agenda is revised license for Langevin Auto Sales and Service to include Ray Langevin.
When we redid it, we were working entirely from the town's point of view. It turns out the state records include both...
the corporation and him personally?
And Ray. Okay. And they're requesting that the local license look the same as their information.
Okay. All right. I'll make a motion that we sign this revised license for Langevin.
Second.
Second. All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, next item is the joint meeting with the Finance Committee.
Sorry, we're running a little late.
Well, let's see. They're next on the agenda. They have a specific time. Yeah, we're going to be working on the town budget with you guys tonight. That's going to take a while?
I'm not really sure what we're doing. I see on here it says 250th department's other budget items. I heard that we were going to be
meeting
hearing from the 250th.
Yeah.
I'm assuming that's
okay.
Not here.
Do you guys... All right, you want to listen to what they have to say?
We can work on Article 2 a little bit. We can hear your news about what you've been doing. And I also have some proposed money articles from the warrant that we can just sort of go over and start thinking about.
Right. I mean, basically, where we're at is that we've gone through recommendations on probably the first two-thirds of Article 2, the small, easy stuff, if you will. We now have a figure for the schools, and for the regional school, and we'll be getting a figure for the grammar school, I guess, Wednesday. It's Wednesday night. So, you know, we're closing in on having all the numbers for Article 2, and I would expect we'll be wrapping up our recommendations in Article 2 probably... You know, if not next week, you know, then the week after. Assuming that all the numbers are, that there's no more numbers in italics, you know, that we get
real
numbers.
Right. And you heard the number for the technical schools is...
Yeah, made a note of that. Well, thank you. Yeah. And then there was the insurance number, which was still up in the air. It sounds like you're narrowing that down still.
Yeah. Trying to.
All right, so let's listen to what the 250th Anniversary Committee has for us.
Well, we just thought we should come and talk with you about the main celebration and what it's looking like for a budget. The last, I believe, 3 years, we've asked for $10,000 every year. I think it's been 3 years.
Last five.
Hasn't been five.
Well,
this would be the fifth. Maybe.
This is the fifth. Right. Yeah. Oh, okay.
I'm sorry.
I'm Heidi Flanders. Sorry. Right. Okay. Yes. Sorry. I'm the new chair, and I just picked it up this year. So I'm trying to. That's why there's some questions of whether it was for 3 or 4 years. But so basically, where we're at right now is between our two accounts, we have about $47,965 in the account. Based on really preliminary budgets that we've put together for the different categories we're talking about for the main events, it's looking to be about an $83,000 cost. And that's not hard and fast, that's just where we've gotten to thus far. Because until we start signing contracts, we actually don't get, you know, solidified numbers and stuff.
Sure.
So with that said, that puts us at needing about a little over 30,000. Now, some of that 83, there's a few items in here. Actually, I should probably get a new copy. That are things we have to front the money for, but we will make the money back on, like the genealogy book and the cookbook that Kate's been working on. So those are things we have to front the money now, but then as the sales go through, we'll be getting the money back. So they're on here in that 83. Here, I need a copy over there. So I think all in all, it'll end up somewhere around 77,000. And so I asked Tom, you know, how should we do this? I wasn't sure. When I first came on, they told me that, you know, you could get money up to a year after, or something was a rumor I heard or something. So the question was, our event is next June. Okay. So
next June.
So we get approval of town meeting this year in May, and then money gets released usually in July. So if we get approval next May for money and our event's in June, then the money doesn't come till July. That's too late to pay for stuff that we owe money on. And I don't have 50 year, you know, any of this money to float, so I'm not going to be doing that. So so the question was, should we just ask for the 30,000 this year? And then we wouldn't have to necessarily ask for it next year because of the timing of the event. So that was kind of what I put before Tom. Tom said, oh, I don't know. Why don't you come talk with us? So here we are. So, you know, I'm trying to hear from you guys whether, I get that 30 is a lot all at once, you know, but is there some way that we can work that out? I don't know, you know, how this all works.
And there are some things, if I can just interject, mm-hmm. I'm Kate French, also on the committee. There are some things that we're going to be selling, like on the posts, you know, that kind of thing, going to businesses or people, mm-hmm. and which will generate some money. So we have some ideas to continue to do some
right.
generation of capital.
As well as all the fundraisers we've been doing. So we've been doing, you've probably seen the Cheddar Challenge, we just did a Sweetheart Sock Up. So each of these events are bringing in anywhere from $1,000 to $3,000 an event, but that's definitely not, you know, 30 grand between now and next June. So we are doing those, and definitely those are helping. So the goal would be to have the money, you know, set aside essentially to pay for all the items, and then whatever's left obviously goes back to the town at that point.
So 5 years ago, or 4 years ago, the town approved $10,000 a year for 5 years.
Is that how it was written?
Right, for a total of 50.
Okay.
So you're talking about 30 now. Now there's 10 coming to you in this next year.
Not yet. I guess if that's the way it was written, then yes.
Additional 20 over what was approved.
Was that a five-year vote?
That's the part I'm unclear on.
It's an annual vote, but everybody knew it was for 5 years. It's an annual vote.
So it has to be voted every year.
Every year we've had to put a new article on the
temporary.
Well, okay. That 10,000 is in that 30,000.
Yes. This does not include a 10 for this year, yes.
Okay, yes. So it's another 20 over what had been approved.
What was originally approved, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes it a little more palatable.
Yeah. I have a question. I noticed that the parade is 20,000.
It's a large number.
How is that?
I have been staring at that number for a lot of months now. And
well,
that's actually less
bands from the different schools who would come came gratis.
You have to pay for them.
We even pay for the Festival of the Hills. We have to purchase the transportation. And if you're bringing anything like the Shriners have agreed to come, we have to pay more for that so we can bring a draw of more people to it.
I wondered if that's...
So in actuality, Jim, that $20,000 is me saying to the person who was setting up the parade with us, no, we can't do $40,000. So, like, we can't fit other things in it if we just assign $40,000 to that. So we've kind of actually worked backwards and said, okay, all these other things need this much, what's left? And that's where we came to the $20,000 for the parade. So basically we're going to make a parade that fits in that, unless we can get sponsorship that will help offset it. So our hope is in the next, actually, 2 months, is that we're sending out sponsorship forms to local companies, organizations, stuff like that, to get them to sponsor pieces like the parade or the music, stage, or the fireworks or something like that. Mm-hmm. But we don't have that guaranteed, so I can't, I can't include that here until we have it, obviously.
Of course.
So that's the hope, is that there will still be more, and hopefully that this actually will come down. But based on where we're at now, what we have in the bank, what we, you know, can guarantee, that's where we're at.
So you're just looking for a Warren article.
I am, and so that was my question to Tom. You know, it was like, I didn't think 10 was going to cut it, and I didn't know that it was a 5-year thing. So that's, sorry for me not knowing that. But so yeah, we're looking for 30 total, and I figured it'd be easier to ask it now than it's sitting there. We can start signing contracts for the actual events, mm-hmm. Which we kind of, some of them we have to do a year in advance, which is this June.
Sure.
Yeah. And that way, you know, everybody's getting paid, not a month late.
Right. So. Jim?
Yeah. So the parade, the scope of the parade at $20,000, that's going to be...
That would be having...
Or are you going to increase it if you get more sponsorship?
That would be the bulk of what we would take out of what we've taken from the town money. If we get extra money, we could put it towards extra things in the parade or towards other items in the event, you know, whatever needs money, I guess, at that point. The goal was to target specific companies for the parade, though, like, you know, I don't know, say a bank or something. Would you like to sponsor the parade? And then you have your banner in the parade, they kick in some money, and then they could have, like, the front spot in the parade or something. So if they do, then that money could also go to the parade, and then maybe some of this could go to a different category, or just means a bigger parade.
Well, one of the things is Greenfield Savings has been very good for the town at activities, and I'm sure they would be a sponsor.
They've already talked about bringing their horses and their, is it a wagon?
Yeah.
Okay, next. So they've already talked about it, but you know, we want to go to them first because they are right here in town. So there's hope that there'll be some sponsorships that will cover some other costs or costs that we haven't thought of yet or something like that.
Okay, so far the town's voted 30 or
40.
3 years, or we've already voted 40?
We knew when we started voting 10,000 a year that it would be 10,000 a year for 5 years, so the original estimate was 50.
So and I'm asking, how much have we already allocated?
40.
40.
So we've gone through 4 years. This time it will be
the question I have, and I know you think that I would double check on that, because were we counting 2017 as the fifth year? Because then it would actually be that we've only gotten 30. And I don't know. I'm sorry, I don't have that in front of me at this point.
I think 16 was.
16 was the year.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that means that you've, if you've got 53 on hand, that you've raised.
So it means we've gotten 40 so far, and we've raised 79, if you look at the top.
What's the donation account?
Those are the two accounts. So the expense count is, I believe, where 30 of that money went. And I don't know why 10 of it ended up in the donation account originally. One of the years, that's where it landed. But there's been ups and downs, and we deposit from our events into the donation account usually. So. I don't know. I'm not up on all the bookkeeping end of this. Sorry.
So basically, there's been about $79,000, almost $8,000 profit made in your ventures so far.
Yes, in our ventures so far, over the last three. I think we've been really doing them for the last 3 years.
Mm-hmm. Have you seen the painting that Tom has?
Tom.
Or is that not to be brought up? It's hanging in the town office. Somebody. Yeah, it could be that's. But I had saying that was that going to be a
donated for
donation? I could be donated
for the 250.
Yeah. We could
to a really nice thing.
They gave us lots of options of how to deal with
well of a farm income.
Okay.
So that would take a select board vote as well.
Okay. Yeah. So that's the idea, is that we, you know, was the question of, can we ask for this all upfront this year, or should we be breaking this 50-50 or 75-25? I don't know. You can advise me what you think here.
Well,
you know?
Most of your parade costs, you have to shell that money out in advance.
Everything we have to shell out in advance, and then we make it back. You know, we've got to put out for the, other than say things like porta potties, they'll bill you once
so
they pick it up.
So if you're waiting to get a portion of this money next fiscal year,
it would be a month late.
The event's all over by then.
Yes.
Well, unless it was certified at the end of.
Unless it was appointed next year, if the other portion was appointed next year under a free cash article. Then it could be spent before July 1st.
If we had a special town meeting, once free cash is certified.
We'd want to allocate that.
I would think it'd be clear to do it all this year.
Yeah, in fiscal 17, which starts July 16th.
Right.
So we want to have that in the works for the event of next June.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I don't know about anybody else, but I'm sure Kate has seen the coin from the 150.
Yes. What our plans are is to reproduce that. I've taken images of it. It's a coin that Bill Burnett's grandfather had, the 150th, and it's a nice knurled edge to it. It's about the size of a 50-cent piece. It's very detailed. It's a beautiful backside with, you know, a bird and the like a dove of peace, and it's just
really
lovely. It really is. So that's one of our ideas, and to sell it. One of the things that we found at the French residence was a box of coin collectors from the 200th, and Norm said, let's donate that and sell them, you know, and because it's our keepsake from the 200th. So we've got some things together, so at some point we'll have a really interesting fair, and maybe the painting, and my eyes did build telescopes and kaleidoscopes, and I got some beauties, and I'm going to donate those. And we have these creative people in here. I know we can go to Bob Compton and ask him for something, and that's what we want to do. We want to do something special for ourselves too, not just to bring people in. This music that we're talking about is bringing in some really interesting, great music that we can all dance to, you know, and listen. And we got Mike Haley looking at not just one or two plays, but maybe three, you know. And I just think that there's a lot of events for us
so we're
all
trying
enjoy.
To capture all of the all the different interests in the town of Conway, past and present is the theme essentially. It's called, actually we came up with a theme, it's called Conway 250th, honoring the past and embracing the future. So the goal was to not only focus on the last 50 years, but also focus on like what is popular in Conway now. Because 50 years ago, if you talk to our member who was on the committee 50 years ago, you know, agriculture was big and all that kind of stuff. And now, you know, people are more into, you know, exercise and being out in the environment. So we've got a piece here that we're trying to put together of like a Conway's Tough Mudder kind of thing, where you've got a challenge in town that will draw people also in to participate in it and get, you know, things that people are interested in now as well as back then. So we have like farm tours for back, you know, for the last 50 years, but we also have the new stuff for now. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to, you know, mix it up a little bit and get both in there. So it interests everybody, not just a particular crowd.
I'd pay to milk a cow.
Yeah,
you know,
she's
gonna
pay
to milk a cow. So I want to get that going.
And I would say, I don't know if we've told you or if you've seen it yet, but we did pick the date. So we are going to do it June 16th, 17th, and 18th. It's a Friday, Saturday, and Sunday of 2017. The incorporation of Conway was June 17th of 1767.
Right.
Okay. I don't mess that one up. So we picked the same weekend that it was.
Yeah, I think that's good.
Yeah. So we'll have events that are going to go on Friday and then all day Saturday and all day Sunday.
Right. Any questions from finance on the way
we
want to
do this?
So I haven't seen the draft article, but you closed it. There must already be an article on there for the 250th, just a different, I don't know what number you chopped there.
For 30,000 right now.
As long as it's on there, you know, we'll need to talk about the funding sources. I mean, we haven't really reviewed any of the special financial spending articles yet as a committee. I'm not sure.
this, we'll add this to the stack.
You actually already have.
So this one.
Community members.
Oh, for the third one?
Yes.
There are two that are not on there that I can go into later.
Okay.
Yeah, it's Article 7.
But I mean, like I said before, I hope that we'll get Article 2 wrapped up, you know, tonight or next Monday, depending on if we've got all the numbers solidified. And you know, then we start considering, you know, the other spending articles, you know, as time allows.
Yeah.
I think your presentation has been fantastic, and clearly, I mean, the timing makes sense to me.
It's a timing thing more than
it's a really exciting thing.
It's going to be, this is that, you know, it's good. It sounds like we've got a better new growth figure, maybe, than we originally thought. So that'll help.
Have a good one, yeah.
Any little bit help, right?
So,
okay, great.
So come to the activities.
Yes. We have a couple of events coming up. We have Irish Road Bowling again, back by popular demand. We're going to have it May 14th. So if you haven't tried it out, get together
a team. Okay.
May 14th is a Saturday, pending weather, of course, because it's been a weird year. So there'll be advertisements going out about that. Get your team of four together and sign up. It's a ton of fun. We're actually going to have a kids portion of it this year, too. So. That'll be fun for them as well. And then I would implore, especially one of the members is already on the way here, we're reinstating the beard contest from 50 years ago for this celebration. Cool. So, starting on June 18th at the Conway Inn, you can show up and pay your entrance fee and have a clean-shaven face, and then you can spend the year growing your beard, or your goatee, or your mustache. Whatever you like to do, and there'll be a contest on the 18th of the weekend of the on the 18th during the weekend of the main celebration for the beard contest. This was a huge thing 50 years ago. People really get into this. I don't know if you saw Asheville's not too long ago. There were people with dyed beards and period beards and father and son beards.
All over the country they have beard growing things.
So it's really popular. People have asked us, so we have started it up. So that'll be an event in June. And then, of course, the Cheswood Challenge will be back on July 9th. We're going to move it one weekend behind the 4th this year.
Good idea.
Yep.
Cheswood Challenge.
Yep.
Here we are. We've been using canes.
We would ask you guys, as the select board, to start coming out to the events as much as you guys can.
Mm-hmm.
That would be helpful, and pass the word along, and all the rest of you. Mm-hmm. Lots of
awesome.
Fun.
We count on it.
Thank you, Kate, Ben, and Heidi.
You need my annual report.
Looks like you guys got it all together here.
So one question, can we publicize this on the TV channel? Can we say that, you know, the beard contest is coming on?
Oh, yeah.
Can we write up a little
get
something?
Get around you?
Absolutely.
Okay. Longhawks.
Okay. Yep. No, who we had to get permission from. So don't forget your cakeforcats@hotmail.com recipe.
And I can volunteer to offer a recipe. I just haven't done it yet, but I've got one of them.
Well, I've got 182 or 81 as of today that I've entered into
a
book.
That's good. That's good.
And gone through, and I have a couple people in town who said that they would take my bucket of recipes and proof them all, and going through covers and...
That's great.
We really got a good town of eaters, I got to tell you. Got everything there.
Wonderful.
Everything.
Thank you guys.
Well, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you for considering.
Sounds exciting.
It is very exciting.
Tom, do you have anything that hasn't been anticipated?
No. I was hoping we could go through Article 2 a little bit, right?
Yeah. Oh, you want to go through Article 2? Okay.
Well, let's see where you've gotten.
Yeah, what are your changes here? Or your recommendation?
We voted Apartment 114 through 294, which is just down there above the grammar school, with the exception of 150, we changed the number. Right, Tom?
Yeah, I kept some in for the visual gov to have an article And we're also still waiting for the insurance figure.
All right, so we may need to re-vote the town administrator one, it sounds like. And then we skip the insurance one, and we skip the... We voted... Oh, and on 159, we voted unanimously, except for Roy, because he had to abstain, because it...
Oh, right.
So, but other than that, we got through, you know, basically, what is that, two-thirds of the warrant.
No changes.
We didn't make any changes, no. Okay. I mean, just the change to the town administrator, we changed that based on information that was that Tom presented at the joint meeting last week.
Right.
But Tom, do you have a final number now for the town admin?
Yeah, it's 88,763.
Oh, okay, that's
instead of 97,63.
That's the number actually that we got too. So we are on the same. We did. We did vote that number. So. Yeah.
No, I meant 98,763. No, sorry. That's a joke.
A little levity is always good.
Are there other updates to Article 2 that we need to know before we... Because we'll be making some other votes tonight on Article 2. We're still using the Article 2 that was on the back of the February 22nd budget.
This is the latest that I have, and it's probably better because it includes Frontier. But the technical schools is still...
Well, you gave us the technical schools number, 204094.
Yeah, that's still wrong.
204094.
But that's the latest I have for Article 2 today. I tried to date stamp it, but the date stamp doesn't go over the table for some reason.
So basically, finance has done all you can do right now, right?
There's more we can do. I mean, obviously, we're going to reconvene across the street after we leave you guys.
Right. Okay.
And work through some more recommendations.
But for now, you're through the first part of this.
Yep.
Okay.
So next week we'll tackle the rest of Article 2 and start on the money item.
When is grammar school coming in?
Wednesday.
Okay. All right. So we'll have. Are we getting tech school? We got tech school.
Yes. The number on here is wrong though, and I just gave the right one out.
Right. Okay. So we're going to have. We should have all the numbers next week, basically.
I'm still waiting for insurance.
Insurance.
It's insurance and grammar school operations too.
So what I would like to do then is that unless something comes up where somebody needs to have a joint hearing, I'd like to have the finance committee meet as a finance committee, not a joint hearing with the select board next week. So that we have so we have time to actually do our work.
Okay.
And then we'll give you our votes after that. If we look at this tonight and we decide that we need to know more information from somebody, we can...
Just ask.
We can either get it from you, or if we have to have a public hearing for everybody, we can do that too. Sometimes it's just small stuff, and we just ask a department head or ask Tom, can you check with so-and-so, what's this piece here, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right.
Could I speak to the management on the side of the room for a second?
Yeah, Ben.
On Article 3, excuse me, not Article 3, fire truck article on Article 3. I've got a little bit of update for you. We're closing in on a finalization of an operating budget for the truck. We've got meetings toward the end of next week with the fire truck company again. Tentative, the way we're hoping it's going to look, and I won't know exactly for sure, is we're hoping this comes in a little bit under $400,000.
Great.
Yeah.
That's better than the
and that was from changing companies to other companies.
Is this still a custom kind of?
Yes, it is.
With the big, big camp? Do we really need a big, big camp? Do we really need a big camp?
Well, the way the firefighting is heading to gyms in the future, it, every town's going to run. I mean, you can look at all the towns and all, everybody's going to run. Because we have to look at, in our own fires, never mind our mutual aid calls, they don't want cars to follow the fire trucks to these fire scenes and stuff like that. So you have to transport all your people. Not only that, but we have to look at our own use, how to protect our own people. Yeah. And we use that five-man cab would be used for our own purposes, for on scene of a fire scene, for rehab. You know what rehab is?
No.
You got firefighters that need a rest for a short period of time.
Oh.
They need to either get in the cool in the summertime, or they need to get into the heat in the wintertime. There's a place for them to get in and out of the weather at, and there's four seats in the back, and of course, two in the front.
Yeah.
And it's things like that that we have to get very serious about, the fire departments are, because it's becoming a big issue for the firemen.
How much of the price of the pumper is higher because we have to get one that fits in our garage?
The first guy we started talking about said $100,000 more. But that was the company that quoted me $525,000. I intend on presenting that question to the guy next week when we meet with him, of this newest company that we're working with. And by the way, the company that we're working with now is the largest manufacturer of fire equipment in the world.
Wow.
We try to stay with the three name brand companies, because if you get away from a name brand piece of equipment, you head, quality-wise, head downhill real fast. So we tried to stay with, we originally started talking with Pierce, which like a green flag Pierce. We're talking with KME, which is like South Deerfield's trucks, that's the second largest or third largest in the United States. They would not fit us a truck in our station. They told us they couldn't build this one. Fit in our garage. So we went to the Rosenbauer, which we're at right now, Rosenbauer America, it's called. They are the largest manufacturer in the world. They're the third largest in the United States. And they're talking substantially less money, and I think that's ground wonderful.
Yeah.
And we got a couple items on the truck that even weren't even on the 525 that are more expensive items that this guy's buying. So you can see the big difference in where the fire truck companies are all over the place.
Wow. I mean, yeah, that's big.
We were baffled by it. I mean,
yeah.
And so we're going to get that final deal. We have made some cuts. I'm not going to deny it. We pulled our wish list back some. But we had to pull it back into, you know, what definitely does a town and county have to have?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Without luxuries.
Yeah. Okay.
Great.
So that's good news. If we save that $100,000, then we're only $50,000 over where we have to be to avoid an override at this point with all of these money articles. There are two money articles that are not on the sheet that I handed out. They're both pipeline related. One of them is a request for $5,000 to help pay the legal expenses of Montague's intervention in the DPU docket, which is finding out whether or not there's actually demand for the gas. And the other one we don't have a figure for, but it's to conduct well water testing and air quality testing for occupied residences along the route of the pipeline to establish a baseline. So those have yet to be presented to the select board even, so we're not sure how far they're going to go, but that's just a heads up. There are two that aren't on the sheet that I sent out. One's for $5,000 and the other one we don't know what it's for.
Oh, it's not really closed yet.
Well,
we have a placeholder.
We have the placeholder. Yes. The details are going to be worked out as we go along.
All right. What number are those articles?
19 and 20. So as I said, those are the ones you don't have on that sheet.
All right, Tom, your update?
Oh.
Does that end the financial portion of the...
Thank you, gentlemen.
Okay, so
we'll... Yeah, thank you very, very much. Thank you for coming in. For committees, we received one bid on Friday for assessing the town's options for community-based solar installation. The Energy Committee will be reviewing it and making a recommendation, probably at your March 28th meeting. This is the third time the bid has been offered, with the committee whittling away the requirements each time. This time, they actually got a bid, and it looks good. So that's very good news.
This is for what, downtown?
It's not for downtown. This should be in back of the school. For a community-based solar installation, a large installation. In other Energy Committee news, the state has released its bid for the combined Conway, Shelburne, and Coleraine solarized project, which the Energy Committee is managing on behalf of the town. Bryce Hereford is the project coach, who will be rounding up Conway residents to join together in order to get a volume discount on residential solar projects. In departmental news, the highway superintendent and I looked at Delabar Avenue with an engineer on Friday, who seemed to grasp the situation very well. I anticipate getting an estimate of engineering and design fees on the order of $10,000, as well as a very rough estimate of the project cost, perhaps on the order of $100,000. I am proceeding in general with DOR's administrative and financial recommendations from its March 2012 financial management report, and will have an update for you next week on progress in addressing the issues DOR raised in that report. We're doing very well, lots in progress, so it's good news. For projects, the South River project will be reduced in size due to the project not receiving landowner for permission for centering the water flow in the stream bed just south of the bridge. The project will now only include the floodplain lowering and associated work on the Rose property and the banks in that area. We hope to present final plans to the Conservation Commission on March 22nd.
So how is that going to affect the overall project?
It will reduce its size somewhat. We're not sure exactly how much.
The effectiveness of the project. How does it reduce the effectiveness of the project if we don't do that?
Well, it will not affect the flow of the water as it comes through the bridge in the center of town.
Well, that's the steering of the water.
It will help stabilize the turn, the curve in the river at the Rose property. So it'll be very good at that point. But it won't do anything to help the properties just south of the
Bovios.
Bridge.
It'd be down by Bovios is where it will have the most beneficial effect.
So we're not going to be centering the river anymore?
Up to the bridge.
No, yeah. There was a... that was the proposal for the water as it was coming out from under the bridge.
Right. And to prevent erosion on the banks.
Yes, one bank in particular.
Mm-hmm. I see. So, have we gotten any estimate of how this reduces the effectiveness of this whole project?
Well, it will completely reduce that part of the project. It will get zero effect from that part of the project. The other part of the project can go ahead and do what it was designed to do. There were really two separate pieces to it, so this takes one of them away. The other piece will work as it had intended, as was intended. And we don't know how much it'll save either at this point. We're working on a revised scope of work on that. That's what we hope to have.
So there really isn't going to be much done on that?
Not close to the bridge. It'll all be done on the Rose property.
Okay. Next time.
And then I covered the other thing in the minutes.
Right. Okay. Thanks, Tom. Any questions for Tom?
Oh.
Any concerns or selection? No concerns. Hearing no concerns. Do you have a concern?
No, I just have a hope. I hope that we will be able to, because if this works positively, that we'll be able to provide some financial support to the Montague effort, since they're the only town that has been given intervener status with our state DPU about the pipeline matter. And you have to get that, and I guess in order to get all the information that the DPU is holding. The other thing that is a concern for all of us, I guess, but may wind up not being a concern, and I've been trying to keep up with that a little bit, is that our state DPU has given its permission to go through the Otis State Forest, which is protected land, but it, in spite of Chapter 97, or what is that, Article 97 of the Mass Chapter, I believe. It's a constitution. It will take two-thirds vote, I think it's two-thirds, of the legislature for that to take effect. And as someone said, it's not likely that two-thirds of the legislature is going to vote to agree with the DPU. And I think it would be a really terrible precedent to break our constitutional law and allow them to go through protected land.
Okay. Thank you, Jim.
Yep.
Okay. The next thing, our next scheduled meeting is for Monday, March 21st at 7 o'clock in the town offices.
I guess so, because the Finance Committee will be meeting separately.
Right, in the town office.
Okay.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
If there's no further business to come before the board, I'll make a motion that we adjourn. Okay, we've got a second. Any discussion? No. Okay, so.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.